to this coastal city. And I think it was in the late 1990s that I first came here, and it was in where I've been to Aloysius before, I've been to Anne's before, and I remember that time we were actually talking about the criminalization in the education sphere. And I'd like to begin with that particular area, because it's an area that even if we see some change in the dispensation that we are all hoping for, the work will become more difficult to do, because there's so much work has been, so much of the work of the first 50, 60 years has been undone in the last 5 years, and so viciously undone, that it will need a very, very committed reconstruction. Not only will it need a committed reconstruction, but I think many persons will need to dedicate themselves to remaining on the outside and to remaining critiques of the dispensation, because there are certain things that come with power that unfortunately make you compelled to act in a certain way. Mangalore itself, the occasion that brought me to the city, have involved different kinds of issues and violations. I remember the whole issue of criminalization of education. I remember during the first NDA regime when there was a whole spate of incidents in the coastal districts. And I remember we going to many of the areas with friends sitting here when unfortunately some sections of the police were seen to be behaving in a certain way. Then I remember the attack on the churches in 2008, which got much more publicity than the Kandamal violence, because Bangalore is visible, Bangalore is upper caste, Bangalore is glamorous, whereas Kandamal is Adivasi tribal, and the Christians attacked there are not so pretty to look at. So there are all these issues that bring you and be grappling with. There's also been a lot of concern about the coastal areas of Karnataka. I have been fortunate to be very closely associated with the Mount Swaran in many of their state and national conventions, which are never held only in the capital city. Fortunately, they always held in various areas. We had a convention in Mangalore also. So that takes us to these places. It brings a very warm association with Karnataka. And I think I'd like to begin by saying, before I get to criminalization of education, that if we look at the issue of majoritarian communalism and assault on state society, because if you look at it, assault on both state and society, we need to be looking at the framework of regional and sub-regional understanding of this phenomenon. The national narrative is not going to work. We need to see how communal forces operate within regions, within states, within the North Karnataka and South Karnataka is different, coastal Karnataka and South Karnataka is different. And unless we as activists and academics develop that understanding of how communal forces are working, I think our strategies to combat these are not going to be effective. I think the reason why people have got tired sometimes unfairly with the word secularism is because we've not managed to energize it with enough of a regional, sub-regional narrative, which includes language, includes culture, which includes poetry and all of that. And I think therefore, formations like the BDT and many other cultural formations are very, very important because they try to do this. How do we talk about defending secularism in the context of an India of 2019, where we actually see that we don't have to just defend secularism, we have to defend the very constitutional apparatus that this entire nation was built on. And I mean, there are young people here as well, and I keep telling young people that, you know, the writing of the constitution, the making of the constitution, the formulations that went behind the constitution did not come out of thin air, and they were not imported from either United States or South Africa. They were actually born out of tireless struggles that took place on the soil of this country. They, in the immediate sense, 125 to 150 years of fighting colonial rule, and the experiences of different narratives, different formations. It could be centrist, it could be left, it could be reformist, it could be Ambedkarite, it could be all of these struggles that were in some way battling the colonial forces at various levels for political dignity, for cultural dignity, for self-determination, for Swaraj, all of these were actually defining what sort of an edifice we wanted to be built. And therefore, when we talk about defending secularism, it will inevitably be that we have to defend the Constitution and vice versa. The two cannot be delinked from each other. And if we look at this formulation like that, then we have to look at not just Article 25 to 30, which is freedom of religion, which is of course important, but I think most crucial is Article 14, Article 21, Article 19, and of course Article 51A, which is the defense of the scientific temper and the defense of the right to question. And then again, I would say that apart from the battle against colonial rule, which resulted in our constitution makers sitting down over 18 months, 20 months, the Constituent Assembly debates, I tell young people, particularly journalists and lawyers, and even policemen, that those Constituent Assembly debates should be a must reading over a period of 2 years. You can't do it together, but you can't read them all together. But pick and choose, read chapters, read how the preamble was actually arrived at. There was no dissenting voice on the preamble. Not even the right wing argued with the fact that there should be justice, social, economic, and political. No, not even the right wing at that time said that there should not be equality of citizenship. So what we are seeing today is an assault on that entire consensus building. We are seeing an assault on the fact that the preamble, which was formulated after a lot of discussion, after a lot of deliberation, after a lot of wisdom and a lot of pragmatism, is being pulled apart by forces who are in power and want to actually shred apart the Constitution itself, because we are committed to that. I mean, we have to read the works of Holwalkar, we have to read the works of Hegdewar, we have to read the works of Munji in his 10-day diary which he wrote after visiting Mussolini in Italy. It's not something I am saying, but we have to read their own works to understand that they believe in actually dismantling the Constitution and bringing back another order, which is a Manusmriti order. So, if we are building up a resistance or trying to build a resistance or trying to reformulate a resistance in defense of secularism, we need to understand our history. And our history is a fascinating history. It's a fascinating history. And unfortunately, when I was talking at Anne's many, many years ago, I used to keep asking, because it was a B.Ed. college, and I used to ask teachers in the making, how many of you actually want to be teachers? So the hands would sort of, one hand would go up or two hands would go up. Because even teaching is not a profession that is chosen first time. It's chosen fourth or fifth or sixth when you don't make it somewhere else. So why as a nation have we not been able to inspire young people in a mission mode to become teachers, to become educators? I think a society and a nation that does not have inspired educators will not see the political rejuvenation that we need. And you won't have teachers who are committed to the values of teaching, to the values of inquiry, to the values of having a classroom full of questions at the end of a lecture, not a classroom that is silent. And therefore, when we look back at our history, and I say this to young students because I'm quite crazy about history, is that, you know, our history is a civilizational battle between the Shravanas and Brahmanas. It's a civilizational battle. It's there every day. If you have a Basavana here, then you have an Ekanath and a Namdev in Maharashtra. And if you have a Buddha, I mean, I was in Sarna not so long ago. I'd gone to the Prime Minister's constituency, but I actually visited Sarna, which is the location of the first sermon of Buddha. The first public sermon was in Sarna, which is just 8 kilometers from Banaras. And what makes Banaras and Kashi so special, and what makes this civilizational root of India so special, is that in Kashi you have Buddhism, you have, of course, Sanatan Dharma, you have Islam, you have Al-Biruni writing for Banaras, you have Gavin writing for Banaras. So there's something called an all-encompassing spirituality, and it's also a very, very vibrant business center, by the way. It's also a big, very, very important money-making center, by the way. So these things have meshed together over centuries, and this battle between the Shravanas and the Brahmanas sees many, many forms. There's a very, very important historical work written by Nanak called Hindutva Samvad. I don't know how many of you have read it. It's available in English. It's very interesting because it's not Hindu Musalman Samvad, it's Hindutva Samvad. So when you have the Turkish coming in, and they're not invasions in the typical medieval sense, but when they came and they settled and they did some debate and dialogue be written that, okay, you come here, you're living here, but what will be the basis of this negotiation and shared space? And this intellectual and sage is asking this question. And it's very interesting that this has always been our tradition of accommodation, even confrontation, but not necessarily exclusion. So I think we need to understand where our traditions come from. We need to understand, for instance, that coming back to the early 20th century and the more recent past, I was talking to a young journalist in Bangalore yesterday, and he asked me something about communalism. Unfortunately, he was not aware of what happened in 1905 in Bengal. And I think that's really sad, because journalists must have a good take in the social sciences. There must be a historiography developed about kind of communal violence that we've seen, and there must be a historiography of partition and the entire upheaval that this entire region has seen. So 1905, actually, I keep talking about, because I say, if you really want to understand why India, despite partition and despite the horrors of the partition violence, chose to remain, and it was a pragmatic choice, not just a principled choice, it was a pragmatic choice to actually choose to remain democratic, republican, and secular. You have to understand the 1890 years between 1857 and 1947. You have to understand why, when Hindus and Muslims came together on the streets of Bengal in 1905 to oppose the British imposed partition, what changed between 1905 and 1935 so drastically that you had Direct Action Day and the Muslim League demanding partition? What was the Hindu Mahasabha doing? What was Savarkar writing? What was the Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh doing? Of course, we must pin the blame on the Muslim League, and we have to. But can we ignore the majoritarian outfits that were pushing the dialogue to the extreme? And the moment you push dialogue to the extreme, you will not have space for rationality. And that is, again, we've seen a resurfacing of that in the last 5 years. So I think the defense of secularism will really mean revisiting our history, our cultural heritage, transmitting it in a language and with technology that is available for young people for easy and ready consumption. Encourage questioning about it, because there will never be an absolute truth even about that history. There will be 10 perspectives. And I think it's important that we allow those 10 perspectives to exist. Because if I, the first book that I edited before this one I wrote was on Gandhi's assassination. It was brought up by Tulika. And it becomes relevant given the crass debate of the last 1 week that we have seen coming out of Indore. That basically the book is called Beyond Doubt, a dossier on Gandhi's assassination. And I thought it was a very important work, and I recommend some of you to look at it, because for the first time it brings to the non-Marathi reader a very important work by my mentor and senior journalist in Marathi, Jagat Fadnis, who had authored this little book in Marathi called Mahatmanse Akhir. And that book talks about the final days of the Mahatma. And he does research and he brings it out. And this compilation by Tulika, for the first time, brings it in English, and I hope it comes into other languages. It was very important that when I read this book in 1998, when Jagat had brought it out, he's unfortunately no more with us, he died at a young age of cancer. He actually points out for the first time probably that there were 5 attempts on Gandhi before the one that took his life. And why does that become important in the context of what I'm saying today? Because the rumor mongering, the lies, and the complete banality of the argument has been reduced to the fact that the 55 crossed to Pakistan, and that's where Gandhi was killed. There were 5 attempts on Gandhi's life before the one that took his life on 30th of January 1948. In 3 of the attempts, Godse was involved. So it was a premeditated attack, there was no doubt about it. And the first such attack took place in 1934. Now what is so important about 1934? 1934 is another crucial year which we need to look at. We look at constitutional making, nation building, and secularism. Because 1934 is the year when a couple of things happen. Gandhi, much reified by the Ambedkarites, and I have a problem with Gandhi in class, but I think it's about time that the Ambedkarites and the Gandhians sit down and have a discussion, because I think there were problems with him, but there were also some extremely sane points that he brought to the table. He was talking as a Sanatani Hindu, and you can critique him for that. He said, for instance, when he was asked about the bill that was being brought in to abolish untouchability. So many of the very conservative right-wing people went up to him and said, how can you ask support such a bill? Because such a bill will actually go against the tenets of our faith. And he gave this historical speech in the Legislative Assembly saying that if any aspect of faith, anybody's faith, impinges on the dignity of any one section of people, that must go. That was 1934. He gives this historic address. 1934 is also the year when the Congress Working Committee, under the influence of the left, not on its own, Subhash Chandra Bose is the president, actually brings the Fundamental Rights Resolution, saying that this is the dhancha we want, this is the kind of constitution we want. Because let's remember that in the initial stages, the Congress is a pretty elite organization. It's not really actually incorporated mass movements. But you see that in the 20s and 30s, leaders like Nehru, etc., addressing agrarian meetings, farmers' meetings, workers' meetings, getting influenced by all sorts of ideas. And for the first time, you have this the Congress Working Committee tabling a resolution saying a fundamental rights chapter needs to be there in our constitution. So all these things are happening, and Gandhi is seen as the big daddy of the Congress, as we all know, and he becomes a target. He becomes a target of the hatred right-wing because he's a threat. He's a threat because he talks about the communal harmony. He's willing to give his life for it, as we saw in Noakhali. As we saw not just in Noakhali, but we saw across the country, even someone like Mountbatten, who was brought by the British 9 months earlier to effect a partition that should have happened much slower so that they would not have been bloodshed, but the British wanted the bloodshed. Even Mountbatten was forced to say that, you know, here is my entire British army, here is one man soldier who's preventing violence in Bengal. So he had that moral authority over people, and that's why he was a threat. Because he also spoke against untouchability, and he also spoke up for fundamental rights in his own way. He was committed to equality very fundamentally. So that is why he was a target. So when we want to understand majoritarian communalism, proto-fascism, the fact that Nehru said that it is majority, it is Hindu communalism that will be a threat to the Indian state. However, our experience, and when I say our, I mean my husband, colleague, Tabitha, and myself, as journalists of the 1980s, we saw that whereas majority communalism certainly is a major threat to the state, we cannot, as foot soldiers of secularism, ignore minority communalism. We must speak up unequivocally, because minority communalism feeds into majority communalism, and the middle voter, who is not the supporter of the right wing, gets swayed when the discourse does not become rational and secular. And that was our experience with communalism combat. We published it for 23 years. We stopped physically publishing it. Now we have an online portal, Sabra Media, because it was difficult to handle the human rights work, legal work, plus the publications. We have an online portal. But our experience with communalism combat, you could see, for instance, that we covered Gujarat from 1998 onwards. The issue was said there was no Narendra Modi at that time in the scenario. But the fact is that the communalization of society and state structures had begun in Gujarat in a very, very marked way, and we had an issue called Welcome to Hindu Rashtra in August 1998. The same year, in November, we were the only South Asian magazine to publish a story on the Taliban. And we did a telephonic interview with an organization for the Revolutionary Organization of Afghan Women, RAWA, which you don't hear of today, because when the West comes in, the leftists are out, very clearly. So with the West over Afghanistan, and you don't hear about RAWA. And we did an entire cover story called Hell on Earth, talking about, and this is long before the Bamiyan Buddhas were destroyed. Bamiyan Buddhas got destroyed 3 years later. So I think we need to understand the processes that contribute to the build-up of communalism that finally results in ghettoization, violence. All these processes need to get not just studied by us, but we need to act against them. You cannot have genuine defense of secularism without secularization of society. And I think secularization of our society has come to a standstill. These repeated bouts of genocidal violence, like we saw in Gujarat, Mashindura, I mean, you have minorities moving into ghettos. You have all cities creating these smaller or larger ghettos. Mixed neighborhoods are not something that we are celebrating. Mixed neighborhoods are not something that we are demanding. Mixed neighborhoods are not something that we are agitating for. Unless you have mixed neighborhoods, you will not be able to dispel the suspicion and the rumor and the prejudice mongering that is so easy for communal outfits to spread about each other. So, when we talk about Bombay 1993, and we talk, for instance, about Muslims who have moved out of the ghettos 10, 15 years, being pushed back because of the violence of 1993, and you find those families finding it very difficult to live within the ghetto. Very difficult. But how can you talk about that? Don't speak about that, because that's not the issue. Issue is that. Which is why when Ankit Saxena was brutally killed last February, I was so angry when I got to know the news that I wrote an article with the Indian Express builder, candle lit to Ankit Saxena. I don't know if you know that incident. It happened in the capital of Delhi. He was just riding a bike with his girlfriend, lover. He was going to marry her at the end of the month on his birthday. And there come her family and just kill him. And I remember writing that article, that there was a lot of defensive reaction from many secularists saying that it's not the same as a targeted program, it's not the same as hate. Of course it's not. But the fact is that if we are not able to look at secularism at all different levels, so yes, state, society, family, secularization. Remember what Baba Saheb Ambedkar said about intercaste marriages. I think the same thing applies to intercommunity marriages. But that's not something we want to talk about, because we've seen a rigidification on all sides. And these are difficult issues. These are not easy issues to talk about, because then you'll find the right wing on all sides joining hands. So, I feel we need to calibrate and read this thing up a language. We need to have a regional battle in defense of secularism. We need to actually create rational spaces for questioning. We need to look at our history books, our social science books, which have, of course, removed the war now. Basavanna was not really there properly in the national textbooks anyway. With great difficulty, we had got Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan back in Maharashtra after he had been removed for 20 years. And now I think he'll probably disappear again. So, the way Shivaji is represented in Maharashtra is an extremely narrow kind of a way, whereas Shivaji does have a lot of subaltern meaning for Maharashtra. We need to understand that he might have another kind of meaning for Surat and Bengal, because we know the kind of tales around Shivaji that are told in Surat and Bengal. But for Maharashtra, for the small riyasat of Bharat, for the fact that he was running an economic injustice battle against Aurangzeb, it was not a religious battle. The fact that we had ministers and finance ministers who were Muslims, so it was not a Hindutva battle at all, it was more a battle for his entire region. All these issues in terms of history we need to look at very, very carefully. Our problem is that we are actually suddenly been taken almost 50 to 100 years back. The level of public discourse has sunk to such an all-time low. And the propaganda machine that drives this discourse, including the corporate machine, including the money, it's not just happened spontaneously. It happened because there are those call centers and there are those troll armies who are at work. So if Dinesh Mantu writes something, there will be something written immediately. If Anand Mukti writes something, if I write something, you will have 100 people writing, because there are certain target people whom they will be targeting. It's not spontaneous. It's never spontaneous. But the fact that there is this entire effort to homogenize the discourse and to reduce it to a very, very low level means that you can't have nuances, you can't have interventions, you can't have rational questions. So all of these battles have to be fought for and reclaimed. And you and I will not be able to rule out the influence of corporate money on politics, even if the government changes, which we all hope it will. We will not be able to change it. One of the most, I have to say this at this forum because it's not a comfortable feeling, but one of the most important things that journalists were talking about over the last month and a half is how come Mukesh Ambani made that statement suddenly in favor of Milind Devla. So I'm putting all this on the table because we are not living in an ideal world, and suddenly you have the Time magazine, which I eulogize a particular gentleman, now talking of him as a divider. So things are happening which are also beyond our understanding and control, and they also influence politics, and we need keep that in mind while always calibrating our strategies with what is available to us and the principles that we are aware of. So all these things will require to be thought of when we talk about defending journalism. The method and manner of organization by communal forces, communal organizations is very, very insidious. It's on a negative, it's always on a negative, it's very, very narrow, it's very linear. It's a linear narrative. So for instance, we can laugh at the memes produced on the kind of history that the Prime Minister has espoused over the last 5 years, but it's not a laughing matter actually, because it's exactly tells you what the chakra is teaching. Whether it's 1200 years of servitude, whether it is Kunti, whether it is stem cell surgery, whether it is Ganesh, this is what you are being taught in the chakra. So if you are being taught this in the chakra, and then you kind of actually come to occupy a very responsible position, and also a very powerful position, then you can even start talking about nuclear warfare, the way, as if it's a kind of a game show. You know, so that's the problem. The problem is, the linear languages are always easier to propagate. Complex narratives are not so easy to propagate. But how do we create young minds? And I believe young minds exist who can deal with questioning and complexity. And I think that's our biggest prejudice in our country is the ageist prejudice. We believe that young people do not have the maturity to deal with conflict or to deal with contradictions. They are dealing with our caused contradictions all the time. They are dealing with domestic violence. They're dealing with violence of a very high order. Young people are dealing with it. Are we able to create and help create classrooms where some of these conflictual situations can help to coach our constitutional rights program? When we discuss, for instance, festivals, the festivals of our country, we have different kinds of discussions. And I'd like to share two or three examples with you. That once when I was discussing festivals, I suddenly had this little girl, small classroom, get up and say, "Ahe Pakri," and she sat down. And then she was scared that she had said something politically very incorrect, so she didn't know where to look and she wanted to run out of the class. Immediately, our task was to make her feel comfortable, but she did not say it viciously. See, what made her feel like that? What was making her say that? And finally, it transpired that she explained herself that she comes from a Jain family. And she happens to be living in a building where, opposite her building, the slaughter is particularly public. Now, it's not too much to ask in a multicultural, multi-religious society for us to demand that all such ritual required slaughter should be happening in a civic manner and in a manner where all kinds of people can accept it. So the moment the discussion took that form, it became very cool, it became very rational, and then finally it became a debate between vegetarianism and non-vegetarianism. The next week we were discussing bullying, and the divide was completely different. Girls unanimously said, "We hate Holi. We want that festival to be banned." And the boys were so aggressive, saying, "How can you ban it? It's our right to do what we like." So the entire debate was on gender lines. Girls saying, "We don't want this festival. You're just using this as an excuse to molest us, to ill-please us." A girl in Bombay even lost her eye because in that water balloon, instead of filling water, somebody had filled pebbles. And it was thrown from a train, thrown at a moving train. She lost her eye. Do we reflect on all of this as a society? If Ishwarchan Vidyasagar's bust can be broken, it's very, very symptomatic. Because these were men and women in India speaking against practices like child marriage, speaking up for widow remarriage in a very conservative society. Which is why we are venerated in Bengal. Which is why other kinds of reformers are venerated somewhere else. Instead of taking those ideas forward, we seem to be in the last 15, 20 years, going almost 50, 60, 70, 80 years back. So how do we bring that discourse back? I think we need to have religious, I was very, very fortunate in 2006. I don't know how many of you remember, some of them may not have even 10 years old. But 2006 was Sankat Mochan Mandir was bombed in Banaras. Bombs were planted. It was 2 days before Holi and it was a Tuesday. Now for anybody who knows anything about Hinduism, Tuesdays and Saturdays are very important for any Hanuman temple. And that was the day when the bombs went off. 21 people were killed. What happens? There was trepidation all of us. All of us journalists, we felt that there bound to be a reaction. Just like after Godhra, we saw a reaction, right? Veerbhadra Mishra was the Sankat Mochan Mahan. He is not just he is the descendant of Tulsidas Goswami. Not only is he that, but he's also a M.Tech in water engineering man. He was, he passed away. He immediately, within an hour of the bombings, invited all the religious heads of the city. The Mufti, the Sheikh Mufti, the Bishop, the Jain priest, the Buddhist priest, got them all together to clean the bloody remains of the blast. And by 8:30 p.m. the party started 1 hour late when it started. He brought the entire thing back to normal. He refused entry to Vinod, that Katyar, what are the names? Abhinay Katyar, Advani, they all came to the door of the Mukta Mandir. He said, I don't want any politicians here. And next morning, Madanpura, which is a very heavily Muslim dominated area in Banaras, we saw demonstrations against the bombing, against terror attacks, large number of Muslims participating. And by the signal given by Veerbhadra Mishra, not just Kashi, but entire India was kept peaceful. You need very prompt action. You need instinctive belief in not division, but in bringing people together. So you need leadership, you need conviction. And I will just tell you one thing, which is there very much in my book, but I think it's very, very important for me as an activist too, that in all 25, 30 years of my activism, I have found allies in the police force. I have found very sound allies in the police force. I have written about them in my book. Whether it is Vibhuti Narayan Rai, whether it is Deshmukh, who deposed before the Sri Krishna Commission and admitted on his written testimony, he said that the police force is bringing in people with a Shiv Sena mindset. He said 80% of my force are people who are living Shiv Sena house. And unless we actually talk about purging this indoctrination, we are not going to be able to deal with the capitalization of the police. When I met Vibhuti Narayan Rai in 1995, he was doing his research on my own.